Hello everyone, and welcome to the Microsoft Security Updates Summary, where I will present a short synopsis of what was released today, November 12th, 2024. My name is Josh Daniel, and I'm a risk manager in the customer service and support organization here at Microsoft. I'm going to start this video with an overview of the release, and then I'll dive into a few vulnerabilities. Please note that the details of the vulnerabilities I'm covering in this video may change, and the authoritative location for information will always be the online content in the security update guide. Before I dig into today's release, I like to compare it to the previous 12 months to see how it stacks up. With that, we've been averaging about 81 vulnerabilities per month, and today we have 91 newly disclosed vulnerabilities in today's set. Of those 91 newly disclosed CVEs, 52 of them are remote code execution vulnerabilities, which is quite a bit higher than our average of just under 31 per month. Remote code execution vulnerabilities are the impact type that typically has the most risk. They would allow a threat actor to install software and other high-level actions. Next, I'll move into scoring, where Microsoft uses the industry standard Common Vulnerability Scoring System, or CVSS. This is a scale between 1 and 10, where 10 represents the highest level of risk. This month, the highest scored CVE, it comes in at 9.9, and it's a little bit higher than our average of 9.6. Next, I'll look at the average base CVSS score across the entire release. That comes in at 8.10, which not only is quite a bit higher than our average, is also the highest average score that I've seen across the entire release in the 5 years I've been collecting, almost 6 years that I've been collecting these stats. Part of that reason is, I'll get into in a couple more slides, but this does represent that this release overall has a little bit higher level of risk than what we've been seeing over the past year or so. Now, the CVSS score is a good starting point when we talk about risk, but it does not include everything. For example, it doesn't include the severity, such as important or critical. It doesn't include the impact, such as the remote code execution impact I was talking about a couple slides ago. It also doesn't take into account publicly disclosed vulnerabilities, and this month there are 3 out of those 91 total CVEs. We've been averaging just under 2. And the CVSS score also does not take into account the known to be exploited vulnerabilities, where this month we have 2 and we've been averaging just under 2 over the past 13 months. Now, publicly disclosed, that could mean a few different things. It could mean that a finder has released a detailed blog with the proof of concept, or it could be as simple as just a simple social media post about, hey, I'm working on this thing from the finder, or a threat actor. And so it could be a wide range of things. It could also be coverage in trade press. But it reaches that threshold of where it's been publicly disclosed. Once it's publicly disclosed, then threat actors will look at that and try and build their own exploit code. And that's where known to be exploited comes into play. These vulnerabilities are ones that threat actors have already figured out how to leverage. And so when these known to be exploited vulnerabilities are out, it means that threat actors are already leveraging this against machines that where no patches existed. And so now there's patches, updates to protect customers from those exploitations. So it's imperative that you prioritize updating, because not only do we have 2 known to be exploited, we also have 3 publicly disclosed where threat actors are already kind of working on that stuff, and have a head start basically in building that exploit code. Okay, let's go ahead and move on to our overview slide, where this month we have a new addition. Windows Server 2025 makes its first appearance here. It is now, this operating system has reached general availability, and so we'll be covering that one in addition to the others from here on out. The Windows side, we've been averaging mid-40s, high 30s and mid 40s, depends on which operating system. This month, as we could see, we're well below that when it comes to the total number of vulnerabilities, and yet we had a higher number of total CVEs than average. And typically Windows products takes up the largest chunk of the numbers when we look at a release. And so this month we have lower Windows, but a higher number of total vulnerabilities, and that's due in large part to SQL Server, where we have over 30 vulnerabilities associated with SQL Server. And so that's how we have lower number of Windows vulnerabilities, but a higher total number, which is usually not something we see very often. There are 8 vulnerabilities in Office, a vulnerability that's being addressed in .NET, as well as a handful in Visual Studio. There's some vulnerabilities in Azure that have updates this month, as well as vulnerability in Defender and Exchange to round it all out. Okay, so the first vulnerability that I will talk to today is CVE 2024-43639. This is a critical remote code execution vulnerability, privately disclosed with no known exploits out in the wild. This has a CVSS base score of 9.8. The attack vector is over the network. The attack complexity is low. Privileges required is none, and user interaction here is also none. There are no documented mitigations or workarounds for this vulnerability. And as far as the affected software, it's all versions of Server OS that are in current mainstream support, whether that's Server 2016, 2019, 2022, or 2025. The next vulnerability that I will cover today is CVE-2024-49039. This is an important elevation of privilege vulnerability in the task scheduler. This one is privately disclosed to Microsoft, but exploitation has been detected on this. The CVSS score is 8.8 on that scale of 10. The attack vector is local. The attack complexity is low. Low privileges are required. And user interaction is not required to leverage this. The way a threat actor would leverage this is that an authenticated attacker would need to run a specially crafted application on the target system, and that way they could elevate their privileges to a medium integrity level. There are no documented mitigations or workarounds for this. As far as the affected software, it's all versions of Windows that are in mainstream support, whether it's Windows 10 and 11 on desktop or Server 2016, 2019, 2022, and 2025. Next, I'll talk to a vulnerability in Windows documented as CVE-2024-43451. This is an important spoofing vulnerability in NTLM. This is publicly disclosed and exploitation detected. This has a base CVS score of 6.5. The attack vector is over the network. The attack complexity is low. Privileges required is none, but user interaction is required. There are no document mitigations or workarounds for this vulnerability. And as far as the affected software, it's all versions of Windows and mainstream support from Server 2016 up through 2025 and Windows 10 and 11 on the desktop side. With SQL Server, we have 31 total vulnerabilities that are being addressed in today's release. 29 of those come in at 8.8. And that's one of the driving factors for the average CVSS score being so high this month. We have 29 very similar CVEs that are being addressed. And that raises that score a little bit because they're all so elevated at 8.8. The key takeaway here is that all versions of SQL Server that are in support have an update this month. So if you're using SQL Server, go ahead and get that update installed. And finally, the last vulnerability that I will cover today is CVE-2024-49040. This is an important spoofing vulnerability in Exchange. This was publicly disclosed, but no known exploits are detected in the wild. This has a base score of 7.5 on that scale of 10. The attack vectors over the network, the attack complexity is low. No privileges are required, and no user interaction is required to leverage this vulnerability. There are no documented mitigations or workarounds. And as far as the affected software, it's Exchange 2016 Cumulative Update 23. Exchange 2019 Cumulative Update 13 and 14. I will note with Exchange that in order to be protected from this vulnerability, you need to be on a supportive version of Exchange. And so if you are, say, for example, on Exchange 2016 Cumulative Update 2022, you will first need to update to Cumulative Update 23 and then install today's security update. So there's two steps for you if you're running on an older version of Exchange. If you're already on one of the three supportive versions of Exchange, it's just a simple one step of installing the security update. But again, if you're on an out of support version of Exchange, you will first need to update to an in support version of Exchange and then install the security update. If you are a Microsoft Premier or Unified Support customer and you would like to attend the full briefing call where we cover more content and are available to answer questions, you can either work with your customer success account manager to sign you up, or you can sign yourself up in Services Hub. All right, that's all I have to talk about today. I want to thank everyone for joining, and I will talk to you all next month.